song, right?
Yeah.
We're going to give ourselves away. So can you imagine chasing God just to give yourself away?
Yeah.
Most of the time, folks, we run away from God, right? Because the thing we don't want to do is what? Give ourselves away.
Yeah.
But you know what happens is this. Once the Lord changes our hearts from the inside out, then we have a personal desire to want to what? To serve Him and to give our life to Him. Because prior to coming into a relationship with God, guess who it was all about?
Yeah.
It was all about you, right? So what God does, He transforms us in the inside, and now He puts a desire there to no longer want to serve ourselves.
Amen.
And so we want what? We want to give ourselves away.
Yeah.
And so we're asking God in a variety of different ways, Lord, how can I serve you? How can I give myself away? And so I'm thankful for our praise and worship team that that's those two selections that they gave us this morning. And so, you know, we're at a good point this morning. Amen.
Amen.
You know, we've been going through the book of Romans for a long time. Anybody know we started the book of Romans? I.e. 2 years ago. Wow. It's been that long? It's only 16 chapters. You can tell it took 2 years to get through 16 chapters.
Well, we got
so I'm serious.
We got some breaks in between.
Oh, we had a few breaks in between. Yeah, we have. But you know, the interesting thing is that today we'll be finishing up Romans chapter 16.
Amen.
I mean, that's something to clap about. Seeking what God desires for what? For us as believers. And
yeah.
So it kind of says that I watched the beginning of the movie and I had patience to go through the whole movie and now I get to see the conclusion.
Amen.
You see, you know, but the problem that I think we struggle with sometimes is that when we look at the scripture, we tend to jump in the middle of the movie. And then we look at that particular passage and we think the whole movie is about what? About that particular passage. But you cannot tell the idea of a passage or the book by looking at what? One particular passage. And so what we've had the privilege of doing and what we've always had the privilege of doing is going through every book, line by line, verse by verse. And you know what it does for me? It helps me study some things that I don't really feel comfortable in studying. And it helps me address some issues that what? Even steps on my own toes, right? It takes me to some areas where I've never seen before.
Mm-hmm.
You see, just like last week, we walked through what? The Hall of Faith, you know, with Paul, and he talked about all those different individuals that assisted him in order for him to carry out the ministry. And the truth be told, a lot of us have never went through Romans chapter 16 and looked at those first 17 verses and kind of preached and talked about it. That was my first time that you hear me preach, right? But what that does for us, it helps us get a very well-balanced perspective on Scripture. And so what we're going to be doing today is we're going to be closing out Romans 16, and then we're going to be starting on another book, and the Lord has shown me what book it is. Y'all want to know what book we're going to be going to next?
Yeah.
Right. No, we're going to be going through the book of Ephesians. Ephesians or Philippians, and so as I just kind of read the introduction of each one of those books, as I kind of just thought about summary statements that I read about each one of those books, the Lord said, go to Ephesians. And so, of course, we won't start Ephesians until August, though. And the reason why is because I'll be out of town. I'm going to Guatemala next month, and I'll be going to Kenya the month after that. And so I don't want to start. You know, it's kind of like starting a movie, and then you got to get up and leave and go use the restroom.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to get something started that we can't complete. And so what's going to happen is we'll have a variety of different topics. We have a lot of the brothers preaching and things of that nature. And then when we get back and we start in August, we'll be able to start fresh with an introduction to Ephesians, and then we'll go straight through the book of Ephesians. And I know that you will be greatly helped as we go through another story of God's revelation unto His brother, to His servants in Christ. And so what we want to do now is we want to get to the book of Romans. And so let's look at Romans chapter 16. Our topic for this morning is the words of praise. Let's go ahead and stand for the reading of God's word. Chapter 16, the last two verses, or three verses, 25, 26, and 27. And it's the ESV version, and it reads like this. It says, "Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but has now been disclosed and through the prophetic writing has been made known to all nations, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen."
Amen.
You know what it says?
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Let us go ahead and pray. Precious Father, we thank you for the opportunity that you provided for us this morning as we begin to go through another passage of your word, Lord. My prayer is that your spirit will speak to us and give us insight that when we leave this place, we will be different than we were prior to coming in. Because the point of saving us is not just to leave us like we were, but the point of saving us is to develop us and to grow us so that we would look more like Christ. And so my prayer today is that you would use your word for your people in order to change us to look more like you. And so I pray that you would give me the words to speak as we close out this epistle that was written to the Romans. Lord, we say thank you today that you allowed us to be steadfast in the way that we went through this book, Father. The amazing things that you have shown us, the challenging things, the eye-opening things about what this book entails as far as believers are concerned. And so, Father, we say thank you for all that you do. And it's in the precious and mighty name of Christ that we pray. Let us all say amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. You know, when you look at the book of Romans, it really ends with a doxology. And really, when you think about a doxology, it's really another word for the benediction. It's the last words that we talk about. But really, it's more than that. It's a praise saying. And so think about this. Paul goes through the whole book of Romans, and at the end, he finds himself praising the Lord because he finished this book of Romans.
Amen.
And everything that he does in this conclusion is the idea that summarizes what the book of Romans stands for. But you know, it's interesting. If you think about it, have you ever had a doxology in your own life? Which means simply this, you're going through the Word of God in your quiet time, and you're reading through it, and all of a sudden you just break out in praise. Thanking the Lord for His goodness. Thanking the Lord for the transformation. Whatever it is, but we have doxologies all the time because it's about praising the Lord for what He's done.
Yeah.
And so even through sermon messages, there's this option to have a doxology, a praise saying, which means, Lord, you are so good.
Yeah.
And so what Paul does for us is that at the closing of Romans, he just busts out in praise and says, Lord, you're worthy. And so as we look through the gospel, as we look through the Old Testament and the epistles and the New Testament, we recognize that doxologies are found all throughout the Bible.
Yeah.
So it's nothing new. But you think about that. Anytime man begins to reflect on God, the initial response should be what? A doxology.
Yeah.
A praise saying about his goodness towards us. But there's a good illustration found in Psalms 150. You know, it's a psalm that is divided into five different books. And at the end of each one of these books, there's a what? There's a doxology or a praise what? Saying where the writer says, Lord, I'm just amazed at who you are, and I just want to give you praise. And we get to capture the praise that is given by those that are writing in the text. Now, it doesn't mean that it's what? It's still written by man, but it's the appropriate response that the Spirit has given that individual to pen what? That particular part.
Yeah.
And so even though this is Paul's doxology in Romans, it's still inspired by what? The Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
I mean, you think about it. As you read through the Scripture and you begin to be thankful for the things that you read, that's the Holy Spirit that gives you the ability to see yourself, to see God, and to render Him thanks.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So it's still what? It's still Holy Spirit orchestrated. And so don't run off thinking, well, that's just Paul's word. But really, we all should have some doxology. We should all have some personal praise sayings. And so just to look back again at Psalm 150, the five books that are broken down, and the book, the first book ends in Psalm 41 and 13. So as we go through what? The Psalm, the 150 books, we see it broken down. The first book in Psalm 41 and 13, it says this: blessed be the Lord God of Israel from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen. This is how what the writer ends this particular book that says what? Blessed be the Lord of Israel for his everlasting love and concern. Book 2, which ends in Psalm 72, 18 through 19, says, blessed be the Lord God, the God of Israel, who only does wondrous things, and blessed be his glorious name forever, and let the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and what? Amen. It's another praise saying, because, I mean, you can't deal with God's word and not get what? Excited.
Yeah.
And where you want to just thank him for your current state and what he's shown you through his word. I feel like that on Sunday mornings, you know, or throughout the week as I'm studying, I'm just getting what? These doxologies. Mm-hmm. I'm just praising the Lord for the things that he shows me in his word. I'm excited. Mm-hmm. Because there's deep treasures that some of us will never find if we don't take the time to get into it.
Amen.
I mean, treasure chests aren't just what? Laying around, but they have to be something that's sought after. And when you find it, there's great treasures. There's great value in the Word of God. And in the third book we notice in Psalm 89 and 52, and when I remember I'm saying books, the end of these books, blessed be the Lord forevermore. Amen and what?
Amen.
The end of book 4, Psalm 106 and 48 says, blessed be the Lord God of Israel from everlasting to everlasting, and let all the people say, amen. Praise the Lord. That's in the text. Praise the Lord. I didn't say that. Praise the Lord, right? And so it's this idea that he's asking all men to join with him in praising the Lord for his everlasting goodness.
Yeah.
Now, do you understand God's everlasting goodness in your own life?
Yes.
Do you know that his goodness is not just for the here and now, but his goodness is for the hereafter?
Yeah.
And I think what it'll be better in the by and by than it is men right now. You see? But it's this everlasting idea that we receive from God, and we have no other choice but to praise the Lord. And then the last one, the book 5, which is Psalms 150, which really is a whole doxology by itself, it reads like this: praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments and flutes. Praise upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Now, what's the common phrase that you hear over and over again?
Praise
the Lord. And so there should be an automatic response from every believer that deals with God's word that we ought to what? Praise the Lord. If you're not praising the Lord, that means there's something wrong with your spirit. I mean, I'm going to say this from example. If he tells you to praise the Lord about 10 times in one chapter, then we have to, that should be something part of who we are. We are praisers of the Lord. And so it doesn't just stop in the Old Testament, but it also goes what? Straight on into the New Testament. And so in Luke 2 and 13, we hear a doxology from the angels. It says, suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men and goodwill.
Yes.
This is a praise saying. And I don't know about you, that's some good news. I don't know what you think, but that's good news that the Savior has been born this day in what? In Bethlehem.
Yes.
And he's come with a specific purpose to take away the sins of those who are in the world.
Amen.
And then in Matthew 6 and 13, we all know this because this is how the disciples' prayer ends. Right? And it says, for thine is what?
The kingdom,
and the power, and the what? And the glory forever and ever. What? Amen. So mercy towards me. And then Ephesians 3 and 20, it says, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think according to the power that works in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. And so why did I spend a lot of time in doing that? Because I want you to see that a praise saying is nothing new when it comes to doxology.
Amen.
It's something that should be on our lips regularly as believers, that we're praising the Lord because we understand something about the Lord. Now, without understanding, there is no
praise.
Praise, right? Without understanding, there is no praise. So if you're listening to this message, you're saying, well, seems to be absent. It's because you don't have what? The connection that leads you to praise.
Yeah.
You see? And so this is just a common behavior of those who know the Lord. And so Paul, going back to Romans chapter 16, and if you notice, he gives this doxology. And this is what's interesting about the doxology. As you look through it, all it is a summary of the whole book.
Yeah.
Catch that, right? He uses three verses, really two verses, to summarize Romans 1 all the way to what? 16 and verse 17. Can you imagine that? Now, you can't come with that kind of understanding and wisdom on your own.
Yeah.
So we know that even in his doxology, it was Holy Spirit feeding.
Yeah.
Because he's going to summarize everything when it comes down to it. So what does he summarize about Romans chapter, well, whole book of Romans? Well, there's three specific things we want to kind of look at today, is that he summarizes that God establishes men.
All right.
Think about that. God establishes men. Now here it says, now to him who is able to strengthen, but in some verses it says to him who is able to establish. And I like that word better than strengthen, because strengthening, we look more like a muscle, but when you say establish, that means you're going to be around for a long time.
Yeah.
And so the first thing we understand is that men are established, and then the second thing he begins to talk about is that we're established through the gospel of Jesus Christ, and then the third thing that he reviews in his doxology is that the mystery that was once hidden is now what? Revealed in Christ Jesus. And so as we kind of back up and kind of look at each one of those specifically, let's look at the gospel that establishes men. Because remember, he's praising the Lord because the gospel does what? Establishes men. Now, see, you don't understand it unless you yourself have been what? Established.
Yeah.
Unless you yourself have been strengthened.
Yeah.
So when you see us all up here excited and praising the Lord like we've been crazy, it's because what? We have been established in the Lord.
Yeah.
And so it's important for us to understand that at the end of it, it's something that God does for us. And so let's just quickly look through that and see how that unfolds. So in verse 25, it says this, and my reading is going to be written a little different because I use a different version. But it says, now to him who is able to establish you according to what? My gospel.
Yeah.
Now let me just kind of clarify that. Paul is writing it, but it's not his gospel, but it's his gospel because he received it from what? From the Lord.
Yeah.
Now, he didn't receive the gospel like you receive the gospel. How do you receive the gospel? Someone comes to you and they begin to proclaim it, and then you get into the Bible and you read it. See, the gospel that was given to Paul was strictly through the power of what? The Holy Spirit. So when he says my gospel, he's saying the gospel that was delivered unto me.
Yeah.
And so there's something about the gospel that establishes me. And that is to say that God is powerful enough, he's wise enough to what? To establish us.
Yeah.
And what does it really mean to say that a man is established? It simply means to be settled or to be rooted in a way that what? That brings you mental stability.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't know how important you might think that is, but I think that's one of the most important things that the Lord does for us, is to give us mental stability.
Yeah.
We just had the foster care worker lady come, Ashley, and she says every year 1,600 children die under the age of 3 at the hands of abuse from people that say they love them. And the reason why they die is because there's an issue with mental what? Stability.
Yeah.
You see? Now,